Access more.
Hey, everybody, it's Bob Goff here, and I am delightfully up in Canada. I'm writing the next book, and sweet Maria and I have been up here for actually a month or two. And so looking forward to continuing to jump in with you guys in the fall. But we wanted to play one of our very favorite podcasts for you, and it's with our friend Sadie. What she has to say is really, it's kind of timeless. So tune into the conversation right now. Today we have Sadie. Now it's Huff.
Yes.
I still call Lindsay Goff instead of Lindsay Vitasich. So back in the old days, but welcome, Sadie. I'm so glad you're with us.
Thank you, Bob. I'm so excited to be on your podcast. I always loved it getting to talk to you.
You know, I think we celebrated a friendship anniversary, an adventure anniversary recently, because I got a photograph of us all in Mogadishu, Somalia. How long ago was that?
Gosh, when was that? I did not even check the date on that, but I feel like it was like 4 years ago. Was it that long ago? Three or four years ago.
And I'm still feeling guilty because somebody like put henna tattoo on your arm. Or can you tell that story? What happened? Because it was I didn't find out for a month or two later. You were such a gracious friend without telling me. You just like got these like nasty burns. Tell us about that.
Yes, I think it. So it, now that I'm thinking about the henna tattoo, it was definitely 4 years ago, maybe five even. But we were in Mogadishu, Somalia, and we were meeting incredible people, and they were learning how to do henna tattoos. So of course, I'm trying to make friends with people that I don't understand their language. So I'm like, try your henna tattoo on me. That would be so fun. Like, that would be a great bonding experience. However, the henna that they were using, there's certain types of henna that a lot of people are allergic to. It's kind of like just not great for your skin. So I didn't know that or even think about that. So I get this henna tattoo all down my arm. I mean, from elbow to hand. And Bob, you remember it was very detailed. And basically everywhere the henna was, it just burnt into my skin. And so I had a scar of that, I guess the font that they used, the design, for a good while. I ended up having to get all kinds of cream to make it go away. But it was a gift that kept on giving, for sure.
Oh my gosh. And they were detailed. I mean, even the leaves had leaves. That was a tattoo. Yeah. I remember the first time I went to Mogadishu, I wanted to blend in, as if I was going to blend in. And somebody told me to get a kanzu. And a kanzu is like a white dress that goes like from your shoulders down to the ground. And so I bought this white kanzu dress thing. And I flew into Mogadishu. I am the only dude in all of Mogadishu wearing a white dress.
You're like, who told me this?
I'm like, what the heck?
That's hilarious.
When it comes to Dream Big, we talk about ambitions, and people have known and loved you, some people close by, some people from afar. But tell us a little bit about some of your ambitions, because there's been so many of them, from your family to your chosen family, your given family, the family you're making, the people you're impacting. Talk to us about some of your ambitions for people that just know you from afar.
Yeah, it's great. So I do have a lot of ambitions. I feel like I'm a pretty ambitious person. And that's probably because, like you said, I have a family who is an ambitious family. You know, I've seen my parents go after dreams that they have that are big and scary and didn't know what was going to happen. And then I got to see God move in that. And so, you know, as I've grown up, I've really started to realize what I'm really passionate about. And that's, you know, seeing Jesus in the hearts of people, seeing people come alive to the good news. And so that keeps me, you know, dreaming of all these different ideas to do that, whether it's podcasts or an app or this or that. But I loved how when you open the podcast, you're talking about, you know, what are some ambitions and why do we not do them sometimes? What's keeping them from it? And we've been talking about that a lot within my circle of friends, because we set out to start a worship band literally 4 years ago. I'm not in the worship band, but I'm writing with the worship band. And so 4 years ago, we started working on this. Maybe it's got to be longer than that. It has to be at least 5 years ago. And we have like consistently worked on it for like 5 years. And we have had so many ups and downs. We have had you know, some momentum, some loss, all of it. And then finally, this summer, we're putting out our first EP. And it is just very, very exciting because the initial dream that we had and the ambition that we have is like, we want to write songs that go along with some of the messages I'm saying, because then people could sing the message over themselves instead of just hearing it one time. They can hear it many times, just like so many other people have done with their messages. So anyways, it took 4 or 5 years of like hard work and ups and downs, and we're here and it's very exciting. But when I think about why you wouldn't step into the ambitions that, you know, you have, is maybe because you tried and it didn't work, or maybe because you tried and it failed. And thinking about how many times we've tried this and how many times probably from the outside it looks like failure, man, like we could have stopped a lot of times, but now it's just one more thing within what I'm able to do that God is using to reach people. And I'm so grateful we didn't stop, and all the moments that we really could have, and maybe even from the outside should have, you know. But it's exciting to be here now. And of course, when this comes out, no one will know that 5 years has been spent and all the things. But I think it's important for knowing those type of things, because you can look at people who have gone for their ambitions and who have dreamed big and done the thing, and you never see the years behind it that it didn't look like it was going to work.
Yeah. Sometimes the impression from afar is that you just wiggle your nose or you click your heels together a couple times and it just happens. Like, it's easy if you're you, but what if you're me? And I think what I'm hearing you say is, gosh, it just takes some time. So get after it. And then keeping your eyes on your own fire, like not getting distracted by all the things happening with somebody else, but living in constant anticipation. What do you do when you live in anticipation? I want to show you, I'm just, because we're on video Zoom here, a text that I got this morning. This is from a guy at San Quentin. He just steps out of the door and he said, "I'm finally free."
Wow.
Isn't that just beautiful? I just go like, this is a friendship that's been born over the last 5 or 6 years from a guy who's been in one of the classes that we're good. And we've got to bring you along, girl.
I would love it.
I can steal you away. He's been in for 10 and a half years. And I asked him, I called him up right away and I said, "Man, what are you thinking next?" The first two things, he got COVID. They gave him a test right before he left. And he's like, "I've got the vid." I'm like, no. So they put gloves on him, wrapped him in bubble wrap, and still walked him to the front gate.
So oh my gosh.
He said, "As soon as I got over COVID, the first thing I want to do is see my new child." And he has an 8-year-old, but he's been in for 10 and a half years. And I did the math really quickly, but there's visitation.
Oh my gosh.
I'm like, all right.
Well,
go team.
That worked.
Yeah. So I want to get fascinated by other story, maybe more interested in other people's story than my own story. Paul is talking about Timothy in Philippians 2:20. He says, "There's nobody like Timothy. He's a guy who takes a genuine interest in other people." And I've thought about you, and a lot of your success is because I think you've taken a genuine interest in other people. You took an interest in me and my family. I've seen you take an interest in other people. Talk about that. Talk about what keeps you curious.
It's great. Yeah. I think I genuinely do care about people and my whole thing. And I feel like it should be everyone saying this is what God calls us to, is to love God and to love people, you know. And if we really do love people well, amazing things happen. And I think, you know, that is what ministry is. It's not speaking on a stage. That's not just ministry. That's a part of it sometimes, but it's really loving people well. And so, I mean, when you said that, I thought about this girl sent me a DM the other day, and I don't know this girl, but she DM'd me and she said, "Hey, Sadie, I read your book, Live Fearless, and I loved it. And there are so many things that I can relate to. And I just have a few more questions because I have been dealing with fear. I've been praying so much and I can't get it to go away." And I was going to DM her back. And then I said, "Hey, send me your number. Let me just call you." And I called this girl. We talked for over 30 minutes, talked about fear, talked about anxiety, talked about panic attacks, then talked about Jesus, talked about scripture. I prayed over her and we had this amazing moment. And I was like, "Hey, don't be a stranger. Like, reach out if you ever need any more advice." And I mean, this is this girl on Instagram that I just saw from a DM, but I saw that she was going through something that I can remember going through. That was one of the hardest moments of my life, and felt like I could offer her some advice. And so we had a great conversation. And I think it's just seeing the people and being willing to stop. Like, Jesus was so good at stopping for the person. Like, I love whenever he was that story about the woman who was bleeding for 12 years, and there's a 12-year-old girl, and he's going to heal, you know, the girl who had passed away. But right here in this moment, there's a woman who needs healing here and now. And so he stopped, and he knew she touched him, and he had this moment with her, and it changed her life, and he was able to get to the other person. So I think if we can recognize that, you know, you're not in such a hurry, your ministry moments aren't just for the stage, it's for the times that you're walking to the stage sometimes. It's so the times that you're sitting at home and you have an extra minute to read a DM or to email, like you said right before, email a Crumble Cookies guy and say, hey, great work for what you've done, which we were talking about before the podcast. But it's taking the time to notice the people, not just notice them, but go the step further and let them know that you notice them and care about them, speak into them, encourage them where they're at. And so I love that you brought that up. I don't ever want to be preaching something publicly that I'm not doing privately. And I think that's what keeps me convicted too, that if I'm going to talk about being a good sister and a friend, and that's my whole ministry, then I better be a really good sister and a friend in the private moments.
Yeah, like that idea of service and what you sell. We want to like encounter people that have a public persona, and then you find out that the real person is actually the same person. Like, they're just at depth, you're the same person that you are. Yet there's an expectation that if people know me from afar, they'll say happy guy, like he's the balloon guy. Yet I can feel really like sad sometimes. I remember just even having a conversation with a really mutual dear friend of us, and just being so gutted. And I just received so much acceptance and love, and man, all just those moments where you can be really vulnerable and to say, man, I'm just gutted by this. And to have that met with so much like compassion and authenticity and matching vulnerability. It's hard to do that with everybody, but gosh, when you've experienced that, man, you seal that friendship forever.
That's right.
How do you decide what are safe places to go with people? Like, to just say, like, because you're constantly, if somebody that's listening, they say, how are you? And they go, I'm fine. But they're just trying to be polite. But then there's other people that want to go a little bit too deep, too fast, and like scuba diving, it'll give you the bends.
Yeah.
Just like, I just can't go to depth because I literally just have a couple minutes and we can't go there. How do you modulate that? So to give us some kind of idea, how can we go deeper, express a genuine interest in other people, but being aware that that may not be the right time?
Yeah, it's good. Timing is everything. You know, waiting to have conversations when you know you can is really important, because it's hard to be intentional with someone when you're in a hurry, or whenever that's not the person that, you know, you need to be vulnerable with. You know, there's that thing in the Bible that says, don't throw your pearls to pigs. You know, you don't just want to give all of your vulnerability to someone that can't steward it well. Now, you can be intentional and loving people in other ways, but the people that you want to be serious with and you want to go deep with, I think there has to be a mutual level of certain trust and also time carved out to do that. Like I mentioned, that girl, I was actually supposed to call her a week before. I told her I was going to call her a week before, and I got really busy, and I was like, this is not the time. I'm not going to be able to give her the time that I want to give her. And so I waited a few days, and then I got home early one day. Honey was down for a nap. I popped some popcorn and I called that girl. You know, it was the time. And so I think, you know, giving yourself grace to know when you're ready, and then giving other people needing to give the other person the grace to know that, you know, hopefully you're understanding that they're trying to be intentional with their time. They're not trying to blow you off. And that intentionality will go a long way. Like I said, we were able to talk for over 30 minutes as opposed to just a couple for me to say, hey. And sometimes it's just a hey moment. But I knew that was a deeper moment based on some of the stuff that she had shared.
Yeah, I think the idea too, when people leave the Oaks, I'll say, we just had a really neat, special experience. And people are going to say, how was your time there? And then maybe your answer is, how much time do you have? Like, is small, medium, or large? And there's no shame in any of them. but don't compress down something really special into an elevator speech when it needs to just breathe a little bit. Don't hurry something when it just needs to, you need to kind of process it a little bit to kind of find a shelf for it or build a shelf if you don't have it.
Yeah.
And not to rush the disclosure of it, because then you actually will lose something in your own understanding of it. But so to slow down, and then people are difficult. I know I'm difficult. I don't think I'm a difficult guy, but evidently I am. We all have these prickly edges. We got a new Highland cow at the Oaks, and it's called Pluto. And so Pluto came at a pretty big, probably 500 or 600 pound cow, and Pluto's got horns. And when Pluto stepped out of the trailer, Pluto went over to nuzzle me, but he like gored me instead.
he's
a really nice cow. And the guy said he had pretty thick accent, and I didn't quite understand what he said. Says something about don't know she has horns. And so then I'm like, what? And about the fifth time I got gored by Pluto, I realized he was saying Pluto doesn't know she has horns horns are above and behind her eyes.
Wow.
So she doesn't know she's got these 3 foot horns. She's just trying to nuzzle me, but she's actually kind of poking in me.
Wow.
And so I just realized I was talking to somebody, and I realized that they were a little difficult. Like they just had some pretty strong opinions about who God likes and doesn't like and all that. And I thought to myself, they don't know they have horns. Come up with a more generous explanation than saying like, what a jerk, or, you know, wow, how conceited, or whatever it is, to just realize, like me, I don't always realize I have horns.
Yeah.
Because they're up and out and behind me. And so to be more generous with people, like, so if somebody does something that's kind of hurts your feeling, to just try to come up with the most generous explanation for that, that maybe they don't know they have horns.
That is so good. I love that. I'm going to have to take that one and remind myself of that with some people for sure.
Yeah, you'll have to, it's kind of like a word a day calendar. You have to repeat that to yourself once today. If you're listening, or Sadie, to say, oh, they don't know they have horns.
They don't know. And that just giving them the benefit of the doubt. It's taking the stress off the moment. It's like, you know what? Christian always says, we talk about ways that we're different, you know, and Christian's like, Sadie's just way better at forgiving people than I am. And I'm like, I don't know if I'm that much better. I think I just forget. Like, I'm just very forgetful. And I'm like, oh, did they do that? Oh, I didn't even remember. They're my friend, whatever, moving on. But I'm going to tell that to Christian, because that's so good. Just giving people the benefit of the doubt, that sometimes people just don't know, and people have bad days, and people, you know, they don't realize that there's a root to something they're believing, and that's coming out. And so that's a great way to put it.
Yeah. Or making some assumptions about what someone's life experience has been like, as I oftentimes assume God's doing the same thing in your life right now that he's doing in my life.
Yeah.
And it isn't premise on being mean spirit. I just assume he's working on the same stuff, because that is 100% of my universe of experience. And to realize, wow, he might be up to something else. And so when somebody says something that's a little wonky, or just trying to like, just realize, man, I just think that it was a nuzzle that felt like an attack. They were trying to nuzzle in, but it felt like I just got like the sharp end of the wrong stick. Yeah. And so to say God's probably up to something in their life, it's hard in the moment to have that perspective, but I think that can be a learned response.
Like
we call it right here, LCE, least creepiest explanation.
That's funny.
I remember going to a church, and somebody arrived a little bit late, and it was all full, but there was one row in the front row. There was one seat that was available, and this woman walked in probably 30 minutes after the thing had started, and she sat down. Sadie, I'm not kidding. She had a boa around her neck. And I am not afraid of a bunch of stuff, but I am not a snake guy. She had a 7 foot boa around her neck. And so I was like freaking out a little bit. And then I thought, least creepiest explanation. You know what I came up with?
What?
Maybe she doesn't know.
You know, sometimes it'd be like that.
Yeah, maybe she just, you know, ducked underneath a branch in the parking lot. It wrapped around, and maybe like somebody else will tell her. I don't need to be the one.
That might be the only explanation that we can take from that scenario.
That's hilarious. So what if we were to approach, knowing that people don't know they have horns, including ourselves, coming up with the least creepiest explanation will prevent you from catastrophizing. To say, oh my gosh, you perhaps have had some people that have done some things that are a little startling. I remember turning on the coffee pot in our kitchen at 5 a.m. and I look outside the window and there's a dude sitting on the other side of the window on my back porch. And so I opened the door and I'm like, hi. And he said, you can always tell somebody's a stalker because he says, I'm not a stalker.
Yeah, classic.
all evidence to the contrary. And he said, I just wanted to experience what it would be like to be on your porch because he read a story or something I wrote about somebody getting engaged on the porch. And I'm thinking in my like thought bubble, like you're going to experience a restraining order. But but to say the least creepiest explanation is he's probably just working on his people skills a little bit. He's enthusiastic and he figured out a way in. And so I'm not saying be naive. I'm just saying I want to replace, because the devil, I don't see the devil around every corner, but he does not want to destroy you. He wants to distract you. Because if he destroys you, that's one and done. If he distracts you, then you will be distracted with Christian. You'll be distracted with your parents. You'll be distracted. You'll be wondering who else is going to come up with a boa and whose boa got loose on the stage. Like you're going to start looking under things and you will not be present anymore. You'll just be in proximity with everybody. And so what do you do to stay focused? Give us some just practical things, because you're not going to get on with your ambitions if you're distracted by all the crazy going on around you. So just give us, as we kind of wrap up, some practical advice on how to stay on track with the things that you want the most.
That's great. I love that. Well, I mean, I threw Christian under the bus with him needing the advice of they don't know that they have horns, but I need the advice of, which I need that too, but I really need the advice of the least creepiest explanation, because I think the enemy distracts me the most with fear. I think about the creepiest explanation, right? So if I see something or something happens to me, I had a moment happen just the other day that was very creepy, and I want to go to the worst case scenario and the craziest thing. But all those what if this happened or this could have happened only leave me so distracted. And you're right, it leaves you looking under things, not being present with the people that are in your life, but just being in proximity. I love how you said that. And so I think for me, I really do have to eliminate my fears intentionally. One thing I did lately that really helped me is, you know that verse that talking about what you think about, and it says, think about what is pure and lovely and admirable and all these things. Think about these things. And I was like, hey, how do I, you know, shift my brain to not think about these fears, but think about those things that are, you know, honorable and worthy of thought. And so I was like, okay, I'm just going to go through all of these words and I'm going to literally find a picture in my phone that reminds me of this. What reminds me of pure? What reminds me of lovely? What reminds me of admirable? And so, you know, I got a picture of my daughter, Honey, because she's just so pure, you know. There was one that was just, and I have this picture of just an excellent leader that I feel like I look up to, and I just wanted to model that in my life. I thought about honorable. I thought about my great grandma. I have a picture of her. And I literally sometimes will just look through these pictures that are all these things, taking my thoughts above. And so now I know these pictures in my brain to where, instead of being distracted by fear, I take myself back to that pure thought of my daughter, that honorable thought, like my grandma, or I thought, what is praiseworthy? I have a picture of the cross in my mind. And so I think that's a really practical way to stay focused on what you're doing in life, or even just on the joy of life or the good of life. Instead of going to the worst case scenario, the what ifs or what could have happened in life, it's what's actually true about this moment right now. And man, that's a daily battle sometimes to get your mind to be focused and not distracted. But it's one worth the fight, right? Because like you said, distraction can be continual and it can keep going for who even knows years, you know, and you look up and you're like, wow, I've been distracted by worst case scenario for the past few years. And I haven't said yes to the things that I could say yes to. I've been saying no to the things that I should have said yes to. And I was there at one point in my life, and I'm thankful now I've worked through that. And I'm showing up in life, and I'm glad to do that. Not because things have gotten less creepy, but because I've just gotten, I think, more centered and more, I guess, I have more faith now and trust that God's got me. And if the Lord's willing, I can show up.
Yeah, and think of the practice as you were hearing Sadie say, like, I do this and this and this. I find a verse. I find photos that remind me. A go-to for me, there's 37 miracles in the scriptures, and I'm always looking for the 38th.
That's awesome.
But like the first one is like water into wine. So you'd say like, what was the miracle? And then what did somebody say around it? So Mary turned to the person next to her and she said, do whatever he tells you to do. Yeah. And then the second miracle, like Jesus is in the synagogue and somebody comes in with all the crazy and he throws it out. And it said that they were amazed at the authority with which he spoke. And then the third miracle. So I can make it through. I've got about 20 or 25 of these things in mind. And so my routine is to go through, do whatever he tells you to do. The authority with which he spoke. Like he took Peter's mother-in-law and cured her. It said he took her by the hand and lifted her up. So I just want to just go through those things and replace some of the fear, displace that room, that vacuum that's going to suck in every fearful thought, fill the vacuum with scripture. I think that the idea of dwelling in Christ is like not an Airbnb that you just stop in, don't unpack and then leave, but just dwell, set up shop there, and then find some of these habits that you have.
I love
that. Well, Sadie, we love you. You've been a true friend, even a friend that's taken scars for us.
Oh, love you, Bob. Hey, I'll take another one. Let's go
you
back.
Or something else. And thanks for loving people well. You've got a book that came out February 1st. And the name of the book is Who Are You Following? Tell us just really quickly, what's the book about?
Yeah, Who Are You Following? It's kind of about social media. It's about following Jesus in a social media obsessed world. So if you have been struggling in any way, shape, or form with social media, I am not anti-social media. I'm just pro-healthy social media, which means pro-healthy people. And so I'm really excited for the book. I feel like social media is something that the older generation hasn't gone through yet. And so we don't have all the wisdom that we have in all the other areas of life from the older generation. And so I'm like, I kind of feel like the older generation's asking the younger to lead, but it's the blind leading the blind. And so wanted to speak some biblical truth into social media and really excited about the impact that it's making. Praise God. And so, yeah, thanks for asking about it.
Well, love to the family. Thanks for spending a little time. You guys have been listening to the Dream Big podcast. And what I want you to do, and I know Sadie would share in this as well, we just want you to go after your ambitions. Like, God doesn't want you to be somebody else. If you want to dazzle heaven, go be you. All right, you guys. Talk to you next time.